young women being mobbed by cameramen while going into a police station. Reporters refusing to respect the privacy and private property of citizens, barging into people's homes, barging into people's buildings, demanding answers of delivery boys, demanding answers of watchmen, swearing on air. And I get the sense that when we read all of the discussions that are taking place on social media, the people have forgotten the rules of journalism. And not just, obviously, the media has forgotten the rules of journalism, but also as viewers and consumers of news, we need to know what the rules are so that you can recognize it when these rules are being broken, so that you can cut the subscription to the channel that is breaking these rules, because that is the only way to make them listen. Ms. Sabha Naqvi, what are the rules when the media is covering a story like this simply to do with personal space?
When things become sensationalized, we have seen this happen in the past the world over. The media, especially the visual media, lands up, stands outside people's homes, mobs them. We can see reflection of that in television shows and all of that. But in this case, it's all linked to various kinds of big distractions, which are helped by the regime. It's deliberate. It's prurient. Every rule of decency, every norm has been broken by the television media. And there's not even, we don't even know whether a crime was committed. It's so clearly, the norms that I have followed is that you do not barge into people's homes. You do make an attempt to see them, but you do not barge in. You certainly don't mob people. But let's face it, television media has been doing that for a while. But in this case, it's become disgraceful because they are doing exactly what it's gutter press to the power of 10. And the gutter means that you go to the gutter and you sniff in the gutter, right? It comes from it's a phrase which comes from the UK, which has two kinds of press. It has the BBC and it has those who stalk celebrities, who follow them, who chase them down with cameras. It's not the only time this has happened, Faye. Let's recognize that. It happens the world over. When a case is sensational, prurient, it appeals to the lowest denominator. But the point is that we have never in India seen such a long drawn orgy of the lowest level of sort of appealing to the lowest common denominator, gone on for so long with the deliberate focus of not looking at more pressing issues. So the press has been flawed for a long time, but this case, we're just seeing the worst of it. Also, it's more galling because there's not even been a crime that we know of.
Defamation. Is defamation the only law really that binds journalists?
I think so. I think there's only one. And a defamation case, if it's filed by somebody with deep pockets, can sort of, let's say somebody with power and money files a case, the journalist can be dragged into court for a long time, right? Even if the case they win in the end. But in this case, the powerful people, I don't know who is backing Riya Chakravarti, what kind of pockets she has, and whether she's going to get into defamation. To be very honest with you, Faye, after a point, I've sort of switched off and I don't actually watch it any longer. I never actually watched it, but I'm aware that this is happening because I'm particularly enraged by the way that we talk about women in this whole episode, so there's a part of me which is so angry at the way she has been profiled as a sort of, seductress, a sort of vishkanya, drug sort of procuring, she is just every kind of gender sort of thing has been just stamped on her. So I've been a bit shocked by that, actually, because this is one of those cases where you really get to see how television media is controlled by these male anchors with their male attitudes. And many of the women are sometimes ready to go along with this level of misogyny. The famous women anchors, they're ready to go along. I would cringe, as a journalist, the kind of profiling of this woman. And when we have no certainty there is a crime, and it's as if you know, 6 hours grilling of her in the Narcotic Bureau security for Kangana Ranaut. I mean, this woman should get security. You know, the whole thing is so bizarre, ugly. It's really reflects badly on our society also, Faye, beyond the media. The fact that people are apparently watching this day in and day out, it reflects poorly on us also.
Leaking of private chats onto the media, where these private conversations are now being read out, violating privacy, walking into people's homes. Where is the legal line here? Because we know where the ethical line is, which has already been passed out of the system, but where is the legal line?
So there's a huge number of problems, Faye. There are firstly the norms of journalistic conduct, right? Now, let's be clear that for better or for worse, the Press Council guidelines don't have major penal action behind them. But there are guidelines that are meant to guide, you know, the media. So on 41, if you look at 41A, it's quite specific and it speaks to trial by media. It says, for example, that an accused is entitled to the privilege of presumption of being innocent till guilt is pronounced by the court. So it makes clear how you have to do this, that you can't say, uska arrest hona chahiye, kyunki usne drugs liye hai, said, nikla ki, you know, Riya ne drugs liye hai, for example, right? Which is the way a lot of media channels are putting it. You can't do it. The media reports should not induce the general public to believe in the complicity of the person indicted, as such kind of action brings undue pressure on the course of fair investigation by the police. So this is something that a statutory body has actually explicitly recognized and said, right, that there is an impact on fair investigation by the police. It's not always advisable to vigorously report crime-related issues on a day-to-day basis, nor to comment on supposed evidence of the crime without ascertaining the factual matrix. The Press Council recognizes the fact that there are selective leaks that frequently happen by prosecuting agencies or by investigating agencies when there is a high-profile media case to build public support in favor of the prosecution because of the previous provision that I just read out, which is that, you know, impact on the processes that could convict them.
Deepa Gangnam has said, who pays if it turns out, finally, that Riya Chakrabarty did nothing wrong after all of these investigations? Who will pay damages that have been done to her reputation and her family and her life? Will it be the people who accused her, the media, the consumers, the police? Who will it be? Can this ever be made good? If in the outside chance it turns out she is in fact innocent.
I'm sure that there will be in the end, after this rigmarole goes on, that there will be no crime. I mean, abetment is anyway. I'm not going to second guess that. I think, like I've said earlier, she should get the backing of some of the top-notch lawyers who, when they enter a courtroom, it matters.
Abhishek Singhvi, the Supreme Court, she had this gentleman in the...
So she should just go and she should, once this part is over, just sue people. Yeah. She should just sue them. She cannot take this lying down. Even she has to put it on the record that she's going to sue them. Presuming that
forward Sabha's point, Faye, there's the provision on malicious prosecution that you can bring, right? If there was no grounds at all to bring a prosecution and they do bring a prosecution, there is a provision you can bring. In my experience, though, having, you know, defended people who have been unfairly prosecuted and, you know, after they're acquitted, they generally tend to not want to take on the state, whether it's for damages or whether it's for to sue them in malicious prosecution, because it's exhausting to be targeted in a criminal trial. It's expensive. It's can push people into poverty who weren't, you know, before.
Sandeep, wouldn't that apply to after the charge sheet when prosecution begins, when trial begins? But right now, as far as these various agencies are concerned, they're just investigating. Yeah. So technically, they haven't begun prosecuting her.
The malicious prosecution provision only comes in after, but she already has lots of ground to bring a defamation cases against.
That's it. Yeah, channels. I mean, I'm not asking her to take on the government, but she should take on a channel and build up a case with the top-notch lawyers.
the one thing you should always remember that I would like you to remember is this, that at the end of the day, newsrooms, newspapers, television channels are all run by human beings, and they will make mistakes. All human beings make mistakes. They will, by mistake, there will be an intern who will put the wrong judge's picture on air. By mistake, there will be someone who will write something wrong on air. The important part is to apologize so that your audience knows not to believe what they saw last night or read in the paper, because it was an error. When you don't apologize, then you're willfully trying to defame, you're willfully trying to mislead, and you're being selfish about it. And that, about aside from all the rules and the ethics, is very dangerous, because people will then believe that what they heard on the news was in fact the truth. The lack of accountability is the biggest problem that we have in the media right now.